Yo, what's up, Square Pippa Gabe? On this episode, we are with comedian Edgar Rivera, a good friend of mine, and we discuss getting injured and having somebody back you up, not letting emotions have a seat at the table, and how your upbringing impacts the way you date and how you move forward in your life. Don't forget to sign up for the Patreon. The Patreon is www.patreon.com/manschool202.
Yeah, Patreon, we do bonus content over there, including listener mail, and we do a weekly bonus show. So when we go off the air, like this week's bonus show, we have a conversation about how much emotion are you allowed to have in a relationship, how someone can make value judgments on you. We talk about the Drake hot sauce incident for sure. And just basically this one, we get into deep about when to know your value and what happens in the relationships when people forget what their values are. So go over to patreon.com/manschool202 to keep up with the bonus content. And thanks for supporting us, because it helps out the show a lot.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man. Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't. Yo, 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 what up? GYB, we get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted, and I am excited. We got a special guest tonight. I mean, I know I've said that 500 times before, but this time I mean it. This dude, but first, wait a minute. First of all, let me say what's up to my dude. Harry, what's popping?
Everything's popping. What's going on? Everything's popping. Everywhere I look, things are popping, man. Things I can't stop it from popping.
What's going on with your Herman Munster grandpa hair?
You gonna give me hair criticism?
Slick back,
What I'm doing is trying different things. Now, I know you can't do that. You're limited to one style.
I could go shaved.
Uh-huh.
I could go not shaved.
Right.
I could go half shaved.
Oh boy.
I could go abrasions. You ever seen me do just abrasions?
What is technically abrasions?
It's meaning a like, dull ass fucking razor. Okay. I cut my head, shaved my head with a broken Heineken bottle.
Okay, so those are all Mad Max style. You could
different
go anything in Mad Max.
I mean, you don't even understand that. So I don't
know. I don't know that. I don't know that life. I got to admit, I don't know that life. I only know this one with the hair gel and the things and the hairspray. But I don't understand
now,
the other life.
Check this out, but somebody I do know. Mm-hmm. Knows about this life.
Okay.
My good dude, my friend, my family, yo, give it up for Edgar, yo. Give it up, Ed!
Yo, yo, yo.
What's going on, baby?
What up, Dante?
How you doing?
I'm good, man. Hearing this conversation with you guys with the hair and all this shit. Harry looked like he's going half gel. Like, he says, you know what? I'm going to save some gel. Put a little bit of gel and a little part. We're talking shit because we don't got no hair.
A little bit.
No.
I go half. I'm trying different things.
You know what I'm saying?
Kind of creepy the way he's looking at himself. It's creepy as shit.
Edgar is holding on. Like, you know how when a motherfucker hanging from a cliff and it's like he got two fingers left? Yeah. Like, let it go,
you know,
Edgar.
No. I'm just lazy. I just didn't shave.
Oh, you didn't shave it today?
How often do you shave, bro?
Like every day, every other day.
Man. I don't know. I'm fine.
But I shower every day. You don't really shower.
Yeah, but that's true. Thank you. You made me think true. About that shit.
That's true, Edgar. That's true.
You fucked me up. I was like, what the? No, but I can't shave in the shower. I don't know why. For some reason, I can't.
Why not?
I don't know, man. Everybody does it in the shower.
That seems like the place to do it.
I need like a mirror.
Get a shower.
You can feel it. How long you been shaving your head?
Dude, I've been shaving my head for years, bro.
And you still can't shave it? You know,
I mean, I could do it in the shower, but I prefer to do it in front of a mirror and look at myself like Harry looks at himself.
Yeah,
with that hair.
Harry does that all. He always looks at himself.
That's true. Well,
his
listen,
whole
he
house is mirrors.
What are you supposed to do? Not. Who am I going to waste this? Why should everyone else have this?
Dante, when you don't shave, you look like this too, right?
Yeah. But you'll never see it.
I've known Dante for 20 years. I've never seen, not even stubble. I've never seen a missed spot. It's very bizarre. I've never seen a missed spot. Like, you know how some guys have that little spot right behind the ear?
Nah, I don't play that.
That little line?
Edgar, you know what you got to do? You got to do it by hand. Like, you got to – I don't really look. You could feel it.
No, I know you could, man. I'm gonna try it.
After and this, I'll tell you this. Here's another thing. I don't know why the podcast went left like this, but fuck it, we here already.
Well, this bald guys, they got some bald listeners. They might need some advice how
so
to do this.
So here's what I found out. It's like, and I learned this from going to barbershops. You know how they do the hot, you go to the barber and they do the hot towel?
Yeah.
So when you're in the shower, right, you don't just shave, like what you run your head, wash your head, hot water run on it, softens the hair, softens the foot. Then when you put the soap on it and you pop, right, it's already soft. So even when I do it, you know how you talk about in the mirror?
Yeah.
Even if you do in the mirror, get a hot towel.
Yeah.
You ever do a hot towel?
Yeah, I do.
So it works even better in the shower. If you let the water run, it's hard to fuck up. It's hard to nick yourself. It's just better, man. And you do it by feel.
Yeah.
You know how you like it to feel, right, when you finish, right?
Yeah.
You know how you have that.
Do you aggressively shave this shit until you feel it like you
until
feel no
until it's bald,
hair?
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't it crazy? I go crazy. Sometimes I'm like, oh, my God. I'm like, my girl's like, what the fuck are you doing? I'm like, oh, God, fuck. I go crazy. And then just
yeah,
like a
just,
few hours, and
you're
like
this
again.
If you do it right, and you know what else? You got to slow down. You know, these bitches like it slow.
Look how fucking confused Harry looks.
Deep. You know what I mean? You can't do like a young dude, like a rabbit, like a sewing machine. You got to bang, hit the bottom, come back. I come back three quarter, back deep, like full deep to the bottom, come back half inch.
Yo, we still talking about shaving here?
Nah, not really.
No. Dante, Edgar, like, what's going on, bro? You want to lick around the whole size. People go straight up and down.
Nah, what? Son.
No,
I do the corkscrew. The corkscrew,
yeah.
The vector. I go in one side, come out the other. The underscoop.
I got short arms, so it's very hard, man.
That's true.
Got
you
short
do got
arms.
Midget arms, though.
Yeah, when I got some short arms, that shit is fucking
you
difficult.
You got midget
man.
Arms and dwarf head. So it's hard. It's not fair.
I'm 6'2 with the reach. I have a 19-inch reach, bro.
19-inch reach.
It's crazy.
Edgar has never hit anybody with a jab ever in the history.
No,
never.
No.
Never
had
jab.
It had to be really up close.
Not unless it was in an elevator or a phone booth.
His jab looked like a left hook. So.
Dude, in an elevator, I can fight. You put me in a big ass.
In an elevator, he'll fuck you up because he don't need no arm room. He don't need no elbow room.
No, not at all.
You should see Edgar on a plane. He's sitting in the middle like nothing. Like, yo, what? Why y'all bugging? I got... You don't need no elbow room, B. Edgar, I miss you, you motherfucker.
I miss you too, brother, man.
It's
I
good
miss
to
you
see
too,
you,
bro.
Man. How's everything?
Everything is good, man. As good as it gets, man.
What
just
you
like
been
everybody
doing?
Else.
What you been doing? What you been up to?
You know, bro, I've been laying low. I mean, trying to get back out now. I had an accident a couple of years ago that completely took me out, you know?
What happened?
Dude, I fell down a flight of stairs and I ruptured my quad completely off my knee.
You're shitty. You know I did that, right?
You did that? You had that surgery?
Harry, how long ago was that, man?
Jeez, probably
about 5 years, 6 years?
7 8 years ago.
Down
so
a
I had a, I was doing, I'll tell you what happened.
Oh,
I was
yeah,
doing man. A stunt for when I was doing Blacklist. And I jumped through a window and I fucking fucked up the squad. Because when you ain't famous, they make you do your own. You got to jump off the building yourself. Like, nigga, we don't have nobody that looks like you. We can't find nobody. No stuntman with a bone in his ear. So, nigga, jump off the building. You know what I mean? I'm like, yes, sir. For SAG pay, I will. So I injured it, which I didn't know I ripped it. And then I'm going down the stairs on the brownstone. You've been to the house, right? You've
yeah,
been
yeah.
to the studio. Iced the fuck up, slipped like the banana peel slipped, like whoop, kicked forward, and popped two of the four quads on my popped them. Mm-hmm. Couldn't move, so I had to go in. I had to go in to like because I couldn't move it. I was walking around. I had to set up for a fucking you know to get it reattached. Did you get it reattached?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I got it reattached and split me on the thigh and fucking went in. But I had another one that was partially ripped, but it was under the two good ones. So they didn't want to, they didn't reattach that one because they didn't want to cut the good one to get to the, because you know you think about quads, but you don't think about it like four.
So you had a upper tear, right?
Really, yeah.
If you think about it. See, mine's was at the end, like right before it goes into the knee.
So it looks like this. So it rolled up.
So it looks like that, and then it goes into the forward. But
and it right, rolled. Oh, right so you there. Got the stem? Yeah, yeah. I went in and I didn't know. This is how I found out I had sleep apnea. I didn't know I had sleep apnea. I go in, I do the surgery. Surgery is successful. Bong. I come out. I'm not breathing. So they have to intubate me. They put the tube down my throat. I wake up, tubes down my throat. I know you don't have a gag reflex. But I do, right?
All right. Wait, whoa.
I'm just saying.
I don't give a fuck about your surgery, man. That comment right there, that one little comment.
I know you don't have a gag, but look. No. I mean, I don't want to get personal.
How do you even argue that? How do you? I do, bro. I do.
That's either true. Way, you're supposed tried. To say that. It sounds wrong. I do.
So I woke up and I'm gagged. I gagged and gagged and gagged and gagged until I was so exhausted that I passed out. I'd wake up, tubes down my throat, I gag, and that's going on for 3 days because they didn't know if I could breathe on my own. And I'm gagging and choking and sleeping and gagging and sleeping and choking. And the whole time I'm thinking, man, ladies and the way they deep throat they are amazing. They're God's gift to the world, dog, because I was like, I had a new respect for women. It changed me as a person. I don't push no girl's head down no more. I'm like, yo, just take what you got. I know it's a lot to take, but get what you get. It's like a buffet. Whatever, all you can eat or none at all is fine with me. So, yeah, that's how I fucking almost died, dog. I died on the operating table.
That is insane.
Remember that, Harry, right?
I didn't know about that until after the fact, though. I didn't know that was going down until after you had come out of the or after you
That's Harry's way of saying he didn't come to the hospital.
That's not true. I did come to the
Harry's
hospital.
Way of saying there was a pandemic because Harry was 5 years ago.
I did come to the hospital. You just didn't,
that was Harry's
just, I didn't
plan.
Know you
that's
had
why
almost
I couldn't,
died
I,
till after.
I couldn't see. I couldn't come to the hospital.
Dude, no, but you know what, bro? You actually went through it, man. That was one of the hardest pains, man. You know, I had my leg. I couldn't bend my leg for 4 months. Without bending it.
Now, how are you now?
Now I'm doing much better, man. I had that.
I still walk funny, man.
Look, and I had two herniated discs that they replaced on my neck as well.
I mean, it was all fucked up.
After this surgery, I started like feeling numbness, dude. I would lay in bed and woke up numb. I'm like, what the hell's going on? And it was just two herniated discs. So I had that surgery.
But you used to do a lot of sports like lint hockey and
what?
He throws that shit at you, so you could be like, "What?" I don't even want to ask.
I don't even know what the lint hockey. You said?
Yeah, he used to play lint hockey, you know that shit.
Harry, you want to ask us
with the triangle biscuit where you got to kick the field goal?
That's the paper football, right?
Yeah.
That
yeah.
one I know. I don't know what lint hockey. Oh, lint with a piece of lint. All right.
Yeah. Lint hockey and a pencil. You never played that, Harry?
No, whoa, I had friends and toys.
That's because Harry grew up in. He's Armenian. They didn't have fun.
That's true. We didn't actually have. We had one toy. I'm exaggerating.
I had no fun.
Are you Armenian, Harry?
I am half Armenian, half Ecuadorian. That's the mix.
Harry, see how I slipped that in so they don't think you're white no more?
That's true. I appreciate that. I'm tired of these rumors.
There's
I don't
rumors
know how these
about
rumors
you.
Get started. I kneel.
You do know why, just... Harry? I didn't know what an Armenian was until I moved to LA.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah, they're
you
out
guys,
there.
Oh, you guys control this shit out here. They got the,
yeah, they run it big out there. It's weird out here on the East Coast. It ain't that. It's a very obscure thing.
In the East
thing.
Coast, we got Albanians.
Yes. Yeah, they're fucking nuts.
I mean,
yeah,
remember the Albanians. In
but
the Bronx.
Yeah, but you know the Albanians was only because it was the Russians was wild before the Albanians came. Then the Russians was like, yo, them Albanian dudes is wild. Yeah, because this country make you soft unless you black. Mm. Unless you black and Puerto Rican, this country make you soft. If you black and Puerto Rican, they keep the pressure on. You never get to be white. Never. You never get to be white. Harry does, though. Whenever he wants.
I mean, I can pass.
He gets the pass. That's why he gets a...
In all fairness, though, let's not fuck around. I bring back useful information when I come back.
You do.
All right. I'll let you guys know what's going on. Because people start talking in that break room. They don't think there's a person of color there. They start yapping.
They just yapping. They'd be like, N-word, 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 monkey, N-word. Yeah. And Harry comes back whispering, yo, guess what they said?
Yeah.
I'm like, I already know, Harry. We know what
passing
they
around
said.
That info.
I go, thanks, Harry, but we already know what they say. Sorry. So what's going on? Was you married?
What?
Were you married?
Nah, man, I done that two times, Dante.
Got married twice, though, right?
Yeah, I got married twice, yeah. And I went into the pandemic single, and now I have a full-blown family.
Met somebody with kids?
You know how people started breaking up in the pandemic? Losing families?
You pick one up.
I got two stepdaughters, two stepdogs. I'm like, I got everything. I had the
Jesus.
Full total
Some
package.
People adopt like a dog or a pet during the pandemic. You picked up a whole family, Edgar.
Yeah, I picked up everybody. I said,
damn,
yeah,
you were like, I'm not going through this alone. I want to do the whole thing.
Edgar, you always make great decisions. That's what I love.
Oh, jeez.
I can see it in your face. Not to say, this
this fucking
so
guy.
You like to go straight to the black diamond, yeah. Edgar, when you go to you try to go to the extremist one, the hardest one?
Edgar's right. Like, yo, I never tried snowboarding.
Right.
But I'm going to try. Let's go to the double black diamond show. I'm in. He's like, fuck that. How old's your lady?
She's on 32, man.
Oh, shit, she's young.
Youngity young.
How old are your stepdaughters?
11 and 12.
Shit, nigga, you're crazy.
I know, bro. Everybody tells me.
You bought a...
You know what, bro? Listen, man. I think... Bro, I got mixed feelings myself, man. You remember that movie, Overboard? Remember that remake they made with the Mexican actor? There was the guy that fell off the boat. And the white girl trying to fucking make him like the slave. That's the same day I wake up every morning. I'm like, whose family is this? Where am I? You know what, man? Once in a while, man, you know, when you meet a good one, you're like, damn, you know, I can't be an asshole and be like, y'all, you're great and all, but those two little kids, you know, I can't be that person.
But, I mean, I get it, but, like, you also gotta, those feelings are something, those are reasonable feelings. It's like, it's almost like you bought a 2020 Corolla, but it had 80,000 miles on it, you know what I'm saying? Like, you got, like... And there's no seats. But the engine is good. You know what I mean?
And it looked good on the outside. That's hilarious. Nah, man, you know what, bro? It's crazy, man. It's crazy, but I'm happy. I'm happy, man. You know, I got one son.
Yeah.
You know? I'm a grandfather, dude. I'm a grandfather.
Really? How old is your son now?
My son is 27, man.
Wow.
I'm a 27-year-old. I have two little grandbabies, bro.
Wow. So you like to do everything out of order.
Yeah,
it's Tarantino style.
He's Puerto Rican. He did it right. Come on now.
You know? Mm-hmm. If you don't have grandkids at the age of 40 and you're Latino, you're not really Latino, bro.
You can't. They'll take your card.
Dude, I became a grandfather when I was 40. You believe that shit? It's fucking boom. 40, boom. You're a grandfather.
Look like shit for 40. God damn.
Yeah. I knew this conversation with Dante was going to be good. I was like, you know what? Dante, what about you? You single still?
Nah, I'm married and I got a little 2-year-old.
Get out.
But my wife left and went to my wife left and took my son to England.
Get out, for real?
Yeah. Why? She was 32.
32.
Took my son's in England. He's growing up. I FaceTime with him and everything. And I'm working it out. I'm getting ready. I'm going to set up some stuff out in England where I could do shows out there and set up a circuit out there so I can spend time with him. But what happened really is, like, Doug, you can't, this is an interesting thing because, you know, I know you said, like, you're happy and you're probably not. And I'm.
But come on, are we really truly happy?
Well, let me. I'm gonna explain. Here's what I learned for myself. You cannot let emotions at the seat of the table. We talk about this. Me and Harry talk about this all the time.
Yeah.
And what I really realize is that part of why I'm in a situation that I'm in and I'm away from my son is because I was 50 years old. I didn't have any kids. You start to think about your mortality and you go, you know, this is an opportunity for me to be immortal. You know what I mean? Because I'm an atheist, so I believe your immortality is in your genes. It's moving your genes to the next level. But I didn't really have anybody that I thought was a good enough mother. Do you know what I mean? I just didn't think I would find somebody that would raise my kid in the way that I give my kid the attention that I thought that I think any kid needs to be raised. I mean, we both come from a period of time where, you know, I don't know, was your father around or he wasn't around?
No, my father was around.
Right. So what I'm saying, but even if they're around, they come from an era where they don't have the emotional acuity to be good parents. Does that make sense? Like, everything is so much more about survival than it is about self-acquisition and self-fulfilling and teaching us how to deal with our emotions, how to deal with our happiness. And then they have their issues because of racism, because of capitalism, because of a lack of money, because of we grew up in the hood and stuff. You grew up in the Bronx, right?
Yeah, I grew up in the Bronx. I was born in Puerto Rico, and then I grew up, when I was nine.
And so, you know, our parents are, in a way, they're just not equipped. Like, it's more about survival mode. Me and Harry talk about this, too, even with his ass. It's like, you know, he's a son of an immigrant.
Yeah.
And it's more about survival than it is about... I'm sorry, Harry. Go ahead. Say what you're
saying.
No,
I'm saying I still have that from immigrant parents, that my head is in survival mode and trying not to spend money when I can't unnecessarily, not spending things on entertainment or joy. It's about surviving. So it's like...
Because you never know when you're not going to have.
You never know when you're not going to have it. So sometimes you get in your head, like, my parents never did anything big for Valentine's Day. Like, you know, maybe there was some dinner, but I bet my dad would get her flowers every once in a while. It's not like they weren't romantic.
Harry's mom did, but not.
My mom celebrated Valentine's Day, but that was not at home. Pops. That was on the road. She played a lot of road games we didn't know about.
She did a lot of road games.
But, you know, it's sort of like me and my brothers all have that of like, no, we're not doing all this bullshit. We're not spending money on these tickets unless it's a fucking good deal. If we spend money, it's a good deal and it's not frivolous. We're not going to go to a movie we kind of might like. You know, we're not going to like, maybe we'll do that. If we're going, it better be good. It better be worth it. And this is the big thing for a little bit. Like, it's a, you know, because you're worried.
That's like me. I was going to buy my 23rd fur coat.
Right.
And I was like, I need to really get my shit together.
Yeah.
Like,
you don't have that.
Do I really want, do I need the 23rd fur coat? Do I really need that? And then I was like, no, you know why? Because I don't have an eel skin jacket. So I'm going with the eel skin instead of the mink.
A second mink. Why get a second mink?
Because it's not necessary.
Ridiculous.
I'm like, what the fuck are we talking about?
Dante, you know you could be a millionaire. Going back to the good point
you
brought,
Dante. You think I could be a millionaire?
You could have been a millionaire, but you wouldn't have had
all this shit. Who said I'm not, my nigga?
Well.
You never seen the inside of my safe.
That's true.
Or that gold microphone.
I got gold.
I think you brought up a good point, and I think the older we get as men, we see that. You know, when we're little, when we're young, I remember, you know, all the kids got to go to great adventures and all the parks and pools. And I was stuck in an apartment where my mother and father painted this apartment because that's how they made a living. Mm-hmm. So you would get mad as a kid because you don't understand it. Now I see it. Now I appreciate it more.
Right,
you know?
Right.
Now it makes me old school. I'm old school. I look at these kids, even these two little girls, I look at them the same way. I said, no, you girls now have to learn to appreciate, because I think that's a thing. That's a mistake parents nowadays are doing. You know, they're giving their kids everything. It's good to give your kids everything, but let them freaking learn the value of
let them earn it.
Exactly. Earning, saying thank you, appreciating, you know, I think it's a appreciation is a thing, or they think this is the service
supposed to have it. But I mean, you know, that's I always say that's the correction is always an overcorrection for the undercorrection in the first place. Do you know what I mean? Like for us, we had none of that. It was all about survival and what I like. The reason why I'm so mentally evolved is because
it's one of those days, huh?
I just woke up. I just woke up. I'm a little silly.
Harry, one of those days.
Okay, I'm a little silly, and I like, you know,
It's the same advice. At the end of the day, Dante does give the same advice. It's just how he chooses to package it on a different day. And today's one of those days where he feels like being self-grandizing.
Well, I got to see the studio is in the house, and so I just woke up. You know what I mean? So I'm a little silly, and it's combined with the fact that I really like Edgar.
That's true.
Now, Harry, you know me, right? You're not gonna.
It's very weird. You don't shit on somebody. You shitting on Edgar as much as you did up top and off the air, by the way, lets you know how much you like Edgar, how much you love Edgar. Because if you don't know him, you're not gonna shit on a stranger. No, it's a very strange thing. You don't shit on a stranger because they're not. They don't play
and
that
Edgar's
way.
And Edgar's going, I wish this motherfucker hated me.
Yeah, I wish I got some professionalism.
I wish Dante hated my guts because this is not. But
the first thing that he says, as soon as I joined the Zoom, yo, your fucking mic sucks. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
We not used to having a PlayStation 1 mic. I didn't even know they made microphones.
I paid a lot of money for this.
Whose phone is that?
Oh, keyboard.
You're leaning on the keyboard.
Yeah, I put the thing on the keypad. Here's the other thing. But for me, here's what and again, we were talking about how I'm so emotionally evolved.
Superior, I think, was the word.
Let's not split it.
Let's compromise. Anyway.
But there was a real recognition for me about how emotionally inept my father was at a very young age. I mean, I think we look at our parents as a Superman. I mean, I know Harry had that. Too. I mean, you grow up with that father figure. Most guys don't even have the father figure. You know, most guys don't have dad or he's vacant or whatever. I had a father figure who had very defined ideas about certain things and on everything, but some of it was good and some of it was bad. And what happened was, this is an interesting thing. I think that people learn in two ways. They either, when they observe the world, they either understand what the similarities are or they learn what the differences are. So what I mean by that is, say if you look at two number two pencils, right? If I say, Edgar, tell me about these pencils, right? If you are a person who learns by seeing the differences, you will say, well, this pencil has a pointier is more sharpened, and this one's a little darker yellow, and this one's erasers used a little bit more. Now, if you see similarities, you'll go, both of these pencils are yellow, both of these pencils are wood, both of these, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So the difference is, neither is better because you ultimately, in order to be full of the full piece of pie, you got to be able to learn both of them. But what happens is, if you understand the differences, your tendency is to always reject systems that are in place. So like if you're a person who is always like if you had a job or something, I'm gonna do it my way. Because I can do it better because I see the differences. Whereas people who see similarities, there's a system in place. Okay, this is the system. I'm going to follow the directions and boom, 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 boom. And they're better off like that.
So would it be a situation where a negative person, probably, I'm going to go by my own experience, I would always see the difference in something because I'm very pessimistic.
But I see it too.
I see it.
Okay. I see the differences too. But the problem is, if you have a pessimistic, I guess, proclivity, You're always going to see the negative because you can always see how it could be better. Does you that make sense?
True. Words to fucking throw at me?
Proclivity? It's like your proclivity is like your, it's like my jam, Edgar. All right, that's my jam. You know what I mean? Negativity is my jam.
Yeah, I'm gonna leave this fucking podcast. I might have to fucking Google some words.
I'll explain it. But the point is that you're never satisfied with the system because you're always tweaking it, mm-hmm. right? So if you have a negative personality, you even when it's good, you're finding something wrong with it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Edgar, right. how did the way you were raised affect the way you were dating or having a kid early in life? Like, how did your upbringing impact that, if at all?
I mean, I was born, I had both my parents. I was lucky enough to have both my parents. I saw what they went through. I saw the love that they had. I also saw the distance. It wasn't because he wanted to be, just work and everything else. So I have that family, what would you say, persona. Like, I love being, I know Dante's going to get a kick out of this. I actually enjoy being in a relationship.
Why would I get a kick out of that?
Your longevity. But listen, no, but I enjoy being in a relationship.
What is it you enjoy about being in a relationship and why?
I think having someone by your side that supports you.
The comfort.
When you got the right one, mm. That's the problem. The problem is that we always try to, find it or make it into someone. We ignore the red flags and we ignore everything. But when you find the right one, it's a great thing to have someone on your side that supports you and you support them, you know? I think going back to your question of how it affected me is my parents. I saw my parents go through everything, but no matter what, they still stuck it out.
Was your mom traditional Latino mom? Like, yo, I'm in it, blah, 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 fight or flight, whatever, but I'm in this. We stay together. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But not so much like fighting, not so much like in his face. My father knew his role. My father was always the alter ego, like the male, he always knew his role. My mom was the one that, you'll still say something, mm-hmm. And I'll say this, bro, and it's funny because my mom passed away.
Oh, I'm sorry, bro.
2 years ago, right, in the beginning of the pandemic, to COVID, right?
I'm sorry, bro.
Yeah, man, thank you, bro. So. And I never got to say it, but the reason we moved from Puerto Rico, I was born in Puerto Rico. The reason we moved from Puerto Rico was my father slipped up in Puerto Rico when I was a kid. He slipped up, he got his little side piece, and my mom caught him. Mm-hmm. So I will always give credit to my mom, because my mom, instead of staying behind and being that person, that's the problem sometimes. If you get caught, unless you want to put from your part and make that shit work, dude, it's never going to work, because that other person is always going to get the negativity.
Right. But she wanted it to work.
Put her foot down. My mom said, you know what? I'm leaving. Dude, in a matter of a week, she said, next week we're going to New York. We were like kids. I was running around in fucking diapers. I'm like, we were on a plane? And she brought us to the Bronx. A month later, he showed up with everything. And never since, bro, after that.
Are you close with your stepbrother?
No. What do you mean, my stepbrother?
Well, I mean, he slipped up. Did he have a baby?
No.
He didn't have a baby.
No. Thank God. No,
it was just a fuck up. Yeah.
Fucked around, but he fucked up and he fucked around in his town, in his hometown. And I asked my mother this later on in life, because I admire what she did. Not a lot of women will pick back their kids and just go to a whole different part of the world that we don't know. And she told me, she goes, if I would have stood there, I would have never, ever, ever been able to trust him. I would have lived miserable. Every time he stepped out the house, I would have thought something negative,
That's a fair point.
Dude, my mom was a strong one. So she was a really strong one in the relationship. My father was strong as the man, but my mom was the one that held everything.
So you're saying she would have never been happy because of being reminded of it in Puerto Rico.
And not just
and the more people knew about it, when you come from, I come from the mountains in Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
People ask me, you from Puerto Rico? I've been to San Juan. I say, yeah, that's the capital. That's bullshit. You've been to the Bronx. I'm from the mountains, bro. So everyone knows each other. And back then it was worse. Now it might be more the people, that you don't know. But back then, everybody was related in one way or another. So
Edgar used to get his water like this.
Now is that a ladle or the handle?
There's a handle.
Handle for the well. For the well.
Dude, I remember when I first came, got on a plane, bro, and I hit the Bronx. And I know every comedian probably has this joke about when they feel the experience of cold weather. My mother brought us here in February. It was freezing, dude. I fucking remember. I got off the plane and I met my uncle. He started putting all these. I didn't know what a coat was.
Right.
I didn't know what the fucking coat was.
Wow. You know, How old were you?
I was nine.
Wow.
Knowing, you know, I'm like, he started bundling me up, and I'm like, what the fuck is wrong, man? This dude wrapping me up, and I'm like, what? And then when we get outside, I was like, this is what it is. This is why, man. And dude,
you know what's interesting is you talk about that. The first thing when you said that about your mother going, yo, I'm out. Mm-hmm. That's something that we teach on the podcast all the time. It's like the boundaries that you set have to be the boundaries that you set. So if you're mm-hmm. saying cheating is not okay, if you stay after the cheating, right, then what you're saying is this behavior is okay, mm-hmm. and you can best assure that the cheating will continue. The thing about that, though, is it's not that you can't change your mind about somebody, but there has to be, like I always say, with an apology means nothing without action. So the fact that your mother left and then your father said, look, I'm going to get this woman and I'm going to get that family. What it is, yeah, you're sorry, but I'm so sorry that I'm going to make changes to make sure that I go and get my kids and mm-hmm. I go get my family or go get this woman that I love. And so because there's action behind that, that's a real apology. An apology with no action is just words, exactly. You know.
And everyone throws it out now. You know.
The other thing is, I know Edgar for a lot of years. Like a romantic man, like he's always been a dude that liked relationships, just liked the goofy, booby booby choopy, you know. But which I'm not knocking that. I mean, that's a dope thing to be in that kind of you know, to be in that state. Like that's a beautiful state. The problem is, everybody ain't your mom. Do you know what I mean? Like the representation of what you see womanhood is mm-hmm. is your mother, because that's what you see. But everybody ain't your mom. And so you're giving this kind of wiggle room for somebody who ain't your mom and doesn't have that dedication to her own personal respect, doesn't have that dedication to the family, to the children, and these other things. And you just assume that women have that because that's what your personal experience is, you know?
Well, you know, I try to do that. I mean, and I always tell people this, man. When it comes to relationships, though, I feel like sometimes we break from one and we try to find the same thing in the other. You know, and not realizing if you don't learn, bro, if you don't, from every relationship, dude, I've taken something. I've learned something. Okay, well, you know what? Next time I can't do this. Next time I can't do that. You know, prior to this relationship, dude, I was done. I felt just like you. I was like, you know what? The nice guy never wins. You know, like you don't truly, it was a hassle. And then the minute that I told myself, okay, I'm done with it, and I find this person who started out as a friend. You know, when I was in the darkest moments in my life, you know, dealing with everything with mom, the fall, you know, I
down
lost
for you. Just so down. Angelo.
When Angelo passed, that shit fucking broke me in half.
Yeah,
bro.
Yeah, you were so close to Angelo,
bro,
too.
Dude, Angelo, you know, I had my fall December 9th. Angelo passed December 18th. I had surgery. I get COVID. I lost my mom. I go through a breakup. You know, and like, dude, it was just like one after the other. But I feel like 2020 was that year that cleansed. That, you know, like it got everything out. So just when I was about to be like, you know what, I'm not gonna worry about it no more. I'm gonna do me. But it's very hard to do you when you're used to a pattern already of
relying on someone. I think when you say I'm gonna do me, I think you were always doing you. I just think you were not doing you with the people who could appreciate who you were. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, I'm fucking with Edgar, but I genuinely like Edgar. Like, he's a good dude, you know? And so I fuck with him because I just, there's a kinship and a warmness and that I have for Edgar just because he's such a fucking good dude. You know what I mean? Genuinely a good dude. And I mean, that's so valuable. Like, you don't really realize how valuable it is. I talk to young dudes all the time, and then, yo, I don't have my, you know, I'm working on my career, I'm in school, I don't got money for day. And I go, Doug, you don't understand that loyalty, telling the truth, credibility, authenticity, being empathetic, you know, what we talk about, authenticity, credibility, empathy, those are the most valuable things that you can possess. It's not your car, it's not your money, mm-hmm. it's not your prestige. Because whenever you deviate from that, it like you have nothing. Mm-hmm. Like, if you're a billionaire and you're surrounded by people who are untruthful, shady, and don't give a fuck about you, you have to spend every day protecting your pile of gold, or you're gonna lose it. Mm-hmm. And so having good friends, you know, it's funny because, you know, when you talk about Angelo was a good dude like that, you know, like he was a genuinely good. It's such a loss. And I think a lot of times people put the wrong emphasis. They put the emphasis and the importance on the things that are not really important. Yeah. That really, and they don't realize it's not important. The analogy I use is, you know, remember when Dane Cook had blew up crazy, right? And he found out his brother stole $11 million from him? I don't know if you knew about this.
No, I didn't.
So his brother was managing Dane. And he found out that his brother was... Harry, you remember this, right?
Yeah, I do remember. I think it was his half-brother, but brother nonetheless.
Like, but he put his brother on and whatever, yeah. Right?
And he found out his brother had embezzled like several million dollars, something like $4 million.
$11 million.
That's crazy.
Now, first of all, the first thing to think about is if you had $11 in your pocket, how much money you got to have in your pocket to not miss $11? You know what I mean? Like, every time you go in your pocket, in order for you to lose $11, you got to at least have $300 to $500 where you can miss. Damn, where was that $11? And you wouldn't give a fuck about it. So Dane must have been making so much dough that he could not miss. $11 million for that amount of time. But think about this. He ended up having to put his brother in jail. The family was shit. Everything went to shit with his family because of embezzlement. Now you got to bring the law in and all kinds of... How many million do you think Dane would have paid his brother to not do that? You know what I mean? He probably would have given him $11 million to not do... What is, you know, to not have to put his brother, you know what I'm saying? Yep. Like, when you think about it on the long end, so loyalty and trust is so much more important than anything else, and we don't value it because we think it comes easy. But when we think about in our circles, how often we have that. I mean, mm-hmm. the reason Angelo Lozado, rest in peace, one of the best dudes I ever met. That dude, anytime that dude is spoken of, he's spoken of in such high regard because he was mm-hmm. such a stand-up guy. And this is across the whole comedy community. Just a yeah. good dude. If y'all don't, funny dude, but one of the nicest dudes in the world.
That was my start. That was the first person I ever saw do stand-up live.
Right.
At first, you know, I had seen Kings of Comedy. I seen it on TV, yeah, yeah. but like live in person, I went to the New Rican.
Yeah, yeah.
And I saw Angelo, and I was like, boom. First person I talked to made me pay my dues,
yeah.
which as a comedian now, you know,
but you needed to do.
I've been in it like 18. I've been 18 years already, man.
Right, right.
I couldn't believe it's 18, but, Angelo taught me like the old school way. Now you got these cats that do one video, and they get a million followers, and they're like, oh, I'm a comedian. No, you're not. No, you're not a fucking comedian, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, to the day he died, Angelo always did that. Yeah. You know, I remember one time we did a show, and I did a good, man. I did real fucking good. And I was giving him a ride home, so I'm waiting for the ride home. Because he always, you know, you're a good job, but you always, and he always used to throw something at me.
Yeah, yeah.
And that night, he would say, yo, Eggie, he used to call me Eggie. He would say, yo, Eggie, yo, tonight you did good, bro. Tonight you impressed me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, finally. Yeah, and you look up to someone, you're like, wow, this means the world. You could tell me that, and I'm cool with you as well, and I'm gonna take it. But Angelo telling me that was like, oh. He was like, man, you really impressed me tonight. But do me a favor, don't you ever take that long to get up to the stage again. And I'm are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but like you said, man, one of those dudes that no matter what, I've never heard anything bad.
Yeah, yeah.
That but name come up, you never hear anything bad. And to me, I think as a man, and this is what I've learned through everything. When you learn to appreciate yourself, when you know your value, when you know that you are a good dude
inside,
you're good, bro.
Yeah.
Now you know how to, and that was my problem. That's why I know that the relationships before didn't work out, because I was relying on other people to make me a
You didn't know what, you're saying you didn't know what your value was.
True that. And now, 2020 did that shit to me, bro. Losing everything, losing the stage, bro. You know what it was, man? I was finally doing good. I was finally, and then a drastic accident like this, I would take you out completely. Mm-hmm. It took you, Dante. I was in a bad fucking place, dude, in a really bad place. You know, I lost my best friend. I couldn't fly out to be there for the memorial. I couldn't, you know, thank God I saw him. I saw him, you know, before, because I took a trip and I saw him at the hospital. But, and then, you know, like one after the other, and then my mom came, and that was the biggest one.
That was the one. Why do you think it took so much of tragedy for you to actually take a look inside? I mean, what do you think?
I think when you get to a dark place, man, you look for that light that you can find from every angle, man. You know, like
yeah, but you also could have not found the light. You could have said, all of this shit is horrible, fuck it, it's dope, over. What made you go, let me look for the light? You know what I mean?
I guess not giving up. I guess not giving up, you know. That's a good fucking question, man. You threw me off with that one.
Yeah.
That's one of those questions that I need to actually analyze and think about it. But it was to the point that I realized how good I was. Not just from hearing what you just said, which, by the way, thank you, and I appreciate
it. Well, dog, you know me.
A lot of people feel the same way.
Edgar, you know I would not say that. You know me.
Yeah, I know, of course.
If a motherfucker stinks, if he sucks, I'm going to tell you, fuck that nigga. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I still celebrate Todd Lynn's death every week. I go to dinner for Todd Lynn's death. So it comes from an honest place, and I'm honest. I'm honest not because of you or what goes around me. I'm honest despite that. Like, I will not give somebody props about something if it ain't true, because not for you so much, but for me, because it's the thing that helps me build my self-esteem, that I know that everything comes out of my mouth is truth and it's credible. And I know that I'm not a disingenuous scumbag. So you can't tell me I suck, because I don't. You can't tell me that I'm not a generous dude, because I'm not. You can't tell me that I'm not an honest dude. So if all of those things are good things to attribute to yourself and your personality, and you are above anybody's criticism simply because you do the work every day, it gives you a level of confidence that other people can't even understand. My question to you is, how, you know, it's really weird to me, because I always knew you was a good dude. From the time I met you, it was just so obvious. Even the sense of, I asked you that question, why didn't you go into the dark place? And I think in my mind, if I can, let me ask you if it was this. The same kind of goofy optimism that you had about relationships, even when the people that you were with weren't worthy of your time, is kind of the same goofy optimistic kind of personality that makes you look for the light. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, even when you were in relationships that weren't giving you what you needed to give, you were like trying to will it. So even if these people didn't have that, because that kind of goofy optimism is the thing that made you make these bad decisions, was also the thing that maybe made you look for the light when it was. Does that make sense?
Yeah, or no? It does make sense. It does. It does. It was a dark moment. dude. It was really, it took me to a place. I've been depressed, you know. I talk about depression, I talk about anxiety. I'm free and open about it even more now. Put it this way, okay, so back in 2020, in September, I lost a good friend, right? Mm-hmm. And I started a podcast. It's called Brothers in Arms. Mm-hmm. Right? It has nothing to do with comedy.
Right.
It's all about mental health, men's mental health. And the fact that we as men need to communicate more. You know
you
what I'm saying?
Like,
we don't talk.
We don't like a lot of men. You like a lot of men.
Yeah, all right, relax. Listen, this guy is gonna fuck up my promo. Back in 2020, I lost a friend to suicide.
Right.
A good friend. And the day he did it, dude, he was texting with all of us, joking around. And dude, his death fucked me up, Dante.
Because you didn't see it coming.
No one saw it coming. And then what do you have to go through as my boy, bro? You couldn't tell me, you know? And then it opened my eyes to be like, damn, you know what? I was that dude. As good as I am, I'm that dude that my problems are my problems. I don't tell you. I don't talk about my problems. That's the way I was brought up. That's what Papi did. Papi never came to me and cried and said, oh, my God, I'm working too hard. No. You know, as a man, you know, you keep your shit to yourself. And my ex-wife was the one that opened my eyes. She was like, dude, we need to talk. I can't be your only person. Because that you need to talk. And I was like, yeah. And I opened up. But my boy Tariq's death was like, wow. It scared the shit out of me. Because how deep do you got to get into a fucking silence where you could actually go to the point of pulling a trigger? You know what I'm saying?
Hold on, I want to get into that, but let's plug your podcast and stuff, and we're gonna do something behind the scenes, dig in a little bit deeper on this personal shit on the Patreon. Man. But plug the podcast.
So the podcast is called Brothers in Arms. You can catch it at www.brothersinarms.tv, and basically it's for us men to learn how to talk, dude. I've cried in this podcast, Dante. Mm-hmm. Right. Open, you know. I do it with Eric Nieves, which is another comedian.
Eric. I saw
dude.
Eric at Angelo's.
Yes. And I have Dr. Dan Radman, so I have a doctor, you know, on the podcast. So it's not just two comics. I have a professional on board, and we get into some deep shit, man. So every guy out there should be definitely checking this out and
spreading
the word about it, because we need to talk more, bro. We as men. You know, and that's why I appreciate you. Because Dante will hit you with a nerve. Dante will get that little nerve inside you, like, oh man, he's fucking with me. But we need to talk about shit like this.
Yeah.
It's the shit that opens you up. It's the shit that opens your eyes and be like, oh, you know what? He might be right.
That's dope. You know? That's dope. Harry, real quick.
Just hit all my social media at Harry Terjanian. That's all my info at Harry
Terjanian. Hey yo, Google me, bitch. You know what it is.
Edgar Rivera Comedy. I didn't say my social media.
Go ahead.
Edgar Rivera Comedy on everything.
Okay. Check me out, DanteNero.com. Click on consult if you need a consultation, one-on-one consultation. You know I'm doing that. GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The Sexual Revolution is being podcasted. Don't forget to follow us, Manschool202 on YouTube as well. We release the shows out there. Yo, I love y'all, man. We are out.